nothing but victory on my mind.
Never gonna stop.
Never gonna stop. Never gonna yield.
We're more than a conqueror.
We're more than a conqueror every time.
Every time.
Every time.
Every time. We are.
We are victorious.
Yes, we are.
We are victorious.
Nothing
can conquer.
Conqueror.
We are victorious.
Oh, 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 oh.
We are victorious.
Oh, 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 oh.
We are victorious. We are victorious. We are
by faith. We've come this far by faith. Hallelujah. And the victory truly belongs to Jesus. Amen. Amen. We're celebrating the 10th year church anniversary of our pastor and first lady of this house. Let's give God a hand praise for them today. Yes. All that we've gone through, we've come this far by faith, and we stand and say the victory belongs to Jesus. as you can relate that in your own personal life, no matter what you're going through, no matter what you're going through, be encouraged this morning and know that even though things may not be going your way today, but because we stand in faith, and because even though we don't see the end, we know that we are winners in the end. Amen, somebody? So it causes us, Sister Bridget, to be victorious, because we are a victorious people. Amen? So Jesus, the victory belongs to you. We give you the glory. We give you the praise, God. Oh, somebody ought to give him an in advance praise this morning. A right now, anyhow kind of praise. Because Lord, the victory belongs to you, oh God. It belongs to you, Jesus. We thank you, Lord, that we've come this far by faith. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Stand against the Lord. No one can, no one will. Who can stand against our King? No one can, no one will.
Encourage somebody this morning.
Cause who can stand against the Lord? No one, no one can. No one,
no one will.
Who can stand against the King? No one can.
No one can.
No one will.
No one. Victory belongs to him.
Thank you, Lord.
Ooh. We win.
I find my victory.
victory belongs to him.
Oh,
oh, oh, oh.
How many believe in miracles this morning? Amen. We're going to invite our prayer partners down to the altar this morning. And if you're in this place this morning and you have a need, no matter how big or how small it is, or how big or how small it seems to you, he cares. And I challenge you to come down to this altar and let someone agree with you this morning. Because he's the miracle worker, amen?
Yes, he is.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
You're worthy, God.
Thank you, Lord.
Praise Jesus.
Oh, you're worthy, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
The one who made the blood to see is moving here in front of me, moving here in front of me. The one who made the deaf to hear, he's silencing my every fear, silencing my every fear. I believe in you, I believe in you, you're the God of miracles. Sing,
I believe in you,
we believe, O Lord,
I believe in you, you're the God of miracles.
We is reaching out to make me whole, reaching out to make me whole. The one who put death in its place, his life is flowing through my veins, his life is flowing through my veins.
I believe in you, I believe.
Sing, I believe.
the God who brings the dead to life. You're the God of miracles. You're the God of miracles. Sing the God who was,
the God who was and is to come.
The power of the risen one.
The power of the risen one.
The God who brings the dead to life.
The God who brings the dead to life.
You're the God of miracles.
You're the God of miracles.
Sing the God who was.
The God.
Jesus. Can we give God some praise in the house? Oh, can you give him your best praise today? Can somebody say, Jesus, has he worked a miracle in somebody's life today? Yes! Yes! Jesus, Jesus, Jesus! How many are happy to be in the house of God today? Family, we have the wonderful opportunity to celebrate our pastor and wife's 10-year anniversary. Let's give them some love. Yes. Amen. If you can, give somebody a hug before you sit down. Give them a high five. I'm happy to be in church today. Amen. Amen. Yes, Jesus. Amen. Y'all happy to be in church today? Amen. God is good. And all the time. Amen. I'm just excited today. Amen. You know, I'm just going to take about 30 seconds and say how much I appreciate my pastor. Amen. When I was in a broken place and I didn't feel like I could minister anymore, my pastor showed me love. And I remember coming here thinking I would never preach or do any more ministry ever again. Sometimes family ministry gets you that way, amen? And I remember sitting down here, and it was the first Freedom Sunday, and Pastor George did the splits up here on this. We're going to have him do that again. And put that man bun up in his hair that he's got. That's why his hair is like that. It forms into this man bun, and he had it over in the office one day. It's off the chain when he puts it in. I love that thing. Put that man bun in just one time. I will throw down $100 for a man bun. I'm not even playing. There we go. Oh, it almost happened. Amen. I'm gonna give you that $100 though. Amen. Not a check. I got to give you cash. Amen. Just one time. But family, the freedom that I saw displayed from his heart, a man that would be so transparent to just be real, I didn't see in ministry. I'd never seen it before in my life. That drew me here when I didn't have anything and any other purpose in any other place. I just wanted to be in the house. Amen. I'm grateful for Pastor George for that. This is the first time I ever wore jeans on a Sunday in a church service. Y'all just don't know. You know what I'm talking about. And one time there was some kind of service where we had to put on a sweat. Hey, I had on sweatsuits and some tennis shoes right here on a Sunday morning. That used to be a bad dream, somebody. And I should have known. I should have just thrown my jeans on today. Now I don't even care whether I have jeans on. Hey, I've been broken free from that type of religious bondage. All right, I've said enough. And I'm grateful for Sister Annette also. I've never seen such a kind, sincere woman that stands beside the man of God in my life. I have not seen that. And so I appreciate you all from my heart, from the depths of my being. I'd do anything for you, and I'm telling you that for real. Amen. I do not mean to get emotional. Let's bring it on back in real quick. Amen. Hey, it's time to vote on Tuesday. Amen. That's a good transition. Y'all need to vote on this election. Amen. We don't tell you who to vote for, but you have a right to. And if you haven't registered, shame on you. It's too late. Now, you better go on and get registered so you can vote the next time. But you know what, family? The beauty is in this democracy, we have an opportunity to be able to give our opinion. Amen? People died for this. People stood in line for this. People cried for this and wished they had the opportunity. Now that we have it, hey, let's exercise it. Amen? And I tell you this, God is in control. He makes a way out of no way. He is still King of Kings and Lord of Lords, even over whatever president we have in place. Amen? So let's be able to do that and give God all the praise. Amen? We have any first-time guests in the house? Amen? Can you raise your hands to our first-time guests? Give them some love. Oh, we can do a little bit better than that. Let's show our first-time guests some love today. We're so grateful that you decided to come and share with us today. Through these double doors to your left, there's a visitor's reception area. Please stop by there before you leave today. We have a gift we want to bless you with. Some beautiful people will meet you. And any question you may have about our church, we'll be able to answer. Our ushers are assembled all around our sanctuary. They have debit envelopes in their possession. You can give by any means that you like. Amen. If you like to give by your debit card, just raise your hands, and they will find you as quickly as they possibly can. You can also prepare to give by a wonderful text tithe opportunity, 816. This should be the number, there we go, 266-4848. It's a beautiful, easy way to be able to give. It will take you just about 60 seconds to sign up, and then after that, as soon as you give, it'll flow through every time, amen? Amen. If you turn your attention to our video screens, our announcements will be beginning.
Coming off an outstanding, beautiful men's event where we were able to touch the city. Men of God being able to shout the victory, to pray together, to march in our city. I'm just excited to see the momentum that our men have right now. And the next question is, Pastor Ray, what do we do from here? Where do we go from here? Fellas, men of Sheffield, we need you to come together on November the 10th at 7 p.m. We have our final dinner. We're going to have a beautiful time. Tickets are only $15 for a great meal with a lot of wonderful delicacies. But we want to come together and talk about the next step that our men need to do to move forward into God's plan and purpose for our church and for our lives. I look to see you there.
All right, fellas, if you're wondering, what are we going to eat? You said we're going to have a delicacy. Well, this is what we've got. Fried chicken, baked chicken, fried fish, macaroni and cheese, green beans, salad and dressing, hot honey butter rolls. We got cake, sweet potato pies. Oh, we're going to eat good. I just want to make sure that you show up and that you're ready for what God's plan and purpose is for your life.
Amen. Let's give God some praise. Amen. What a blessing. Added to that is some peach cobbler, somebody. And some apple cobbler. Amen. But the key thing, gentlemen, and I'll say this. This is the last day that you can get a ticket, please, right out there next to the Resource Center. If you haven't gotten a ticket, there's some great things we've got planned for next year. That's really what matters. Keith made me do all that wonderful exhortation of stuff that we're going to have, which is great. But I really sense God doing something in our men. Can I get an amen in the house? We're talking about some powerful things, some conferences coming next year right here within our church. So we need the men of God to be able to hear about the powerful things that we're going to do. Amen? And so there aren't any tickets sold at the door. So you've got to get your ticket today. This is the last day to be able to make that happen right out here. It's only $15. Peachtree will be catering the process, and we're going to have a good time. Amen? The SFLC Cafe is today, right after this service. The menu is open-faced turkey sandwiches with home-style mashed potatoes, dessert, drinks, right after this service across the street in the gym. Make sure you go by there and just share together as a family. Amen? Pastor Westlake will be in the lobby right after this service. For information about the dynamic trip that's going to be taking place in Israel, make sure you stop by there and talk to him about all the great things that are going to be taking place, deposit, etc. Amen? Remember to bring your Operation Christmas boxes back on Sunday, November 13th and 20th. Please call Mary at the office for more information about that. Amen? It's time to get our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Oh, you know how I say it. We clapping like our hands hurt, family. Amen? It's time to give to Jesus right now. Can we give some joy? You know, our Bible teaches us to give our first fruit. Amen? The Bible says over and over again about the reality of tithe, and that's that tenth, that first of what we have to be able to bless God with and be able to see his blessings flow in our life. How many are waiting for the blessings of God to pour out in your life? Not just financially, but in every area. Do we got any faithful folks in the house that's been giving? Amen? I just need to know, has God blessed anybody in the house because they've given faithfully? Has he made a way when there was no way? Has he opened a door when you felt all other doors were closed? God is a miraculous God. Tithe and offering is something that doesn't make sense. It's just something that we have to be faithful and do. Amen? Out of that faithfulness, God just makes a way for us. He opens up doors. He provides for us. That's where the blessing may come with a promotion or whatever else that God's going to do. But he makes a way for us. Amen? Sometimes it's just keeping that car that you paid off running. Can I get an amen in the house? You hear what I'm saying? Hey, that air conditioner that looked like it's on its last leg in your house just keeps on working a little bit longer till you finally get a little extra. See, God works it out for his people. Amen? And sometimes it's hard to quantify, but let me tell you what, God knows our need, amen? Let's give unto him and bless him. Let's bow our heads together. Lord, we just thank you today. Lord, I thank you for the opportunity, the blessing, the privilege to be able to worship you in our giving. Lord, it shows our heart's desire to bless you and be faithful to you and to do what your word says. We give you all the praise and all the glory and all the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, everybody said together, amen.
Good morning, Sheffield.
Morning.
Good morning. Someone say late in the midnight hour. God's going to turn it around. Is he turning it around for somebody out there?
Praise the Lord.
Oh, come on, give him some praise.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. We are honored to be here to honor our pastor and first lady. We're so blessed by them. God has done some amazing things over this last 10 years. But in Romans 13, 7, it says, render to all dues, tribute to whom tribute is due, custom to whom custom, fear to whom fear, and honor to whom honor. So we honor you, Pastor. We're so thankful for God. Come on, yeah, you can give him some praise and honor God for our pastor and honoring them. Thank you, Lord. We're so thankful to God over the last 10 years. I know both my wife and I can attest and say that we have watched God do some tremendous things in our lives through this ministry that has been led by our pastor and first lady.
Amen. 10 years ago, I was facing some really, really hard trials and storms, and I am so thankful that I was a part of this ministry with love and counseling and hope. I was blessed and I made it through. So thankful.
So we can say that many of us have been changed. We've been healed.
Thank you, Jesus.
We've been delivered. And it's all happened. And we are thankful for God because God sent us a shepherd that those things were manifesting in our lives. We want you to worship with us. We're going to ask you to stand. There's going to be words up on the screen for you. And we want to take this time corporately just to worship and thank God for these 10 years and what he's done in our lives.
Thank you, God.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
Thank you, Lord.
Oh, oh, yes. Oh, yes. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, say, I've been changed.
I've been changed.
Healed.
Healed.
Oh, free.
Free.
Delivered. Say, I found
joy
unspeakable.
Yes, I have.
Oh,
grace,
yes, peace and grace.
Grace
and favor.
And favor.
Come on, say it again. You got it now.
I've been changed.
How many of you been changed this morning? Yes. Come on, I've been healed.
Yes,
my heart's been healed. And free.
Delivered.
I've been changed.
Hallelujah.
We don't have to go back.
Hallelujah.
No, no. Yes. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. Pretty good group, but not everybody heard me probably. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. He is good. Hallelujah. I have so much to thank the Lord. First of all, I'm very thankful because he listens to prayers. He has heard one of many of my prayers, and one of my prayers was for me to have the opportunity to one day thank our pastors publicly for what they have done in my life and in the lives of my family. If you understood exactly what God has done through our pastors, you would be clapping harder. I can guarantee you that. Because when I came to this church in 2012, I came to this church covered in shame. And so much shame and so much guilt and feeling so unworthy to even be here that I didn't want anybody to know who I was. I didn't even want people to even know my name because I wanted to be so invisible in this church because I felt so much shame. I don't know how many have been there before, but that's where I was at in 2012. But through the ministry that our First Lady, Sister Annette, leads, through her ministry, through the women's ministry, that year they were doing a Breaking Free class. And I still have this as a reminder because that year, through that ministry that our Sister Annette leads, I was broken free of shame. And it didn't stop there. It was placed in her heart, and I'm sure in the rest of that board, to have another guest in the fall that same year to preach about breaking free from shame. So that day, I'm telling you, sister, I had all the burgers and everything just coming down, and I did not care because nobody knew me. And God was breaking me free that day. I couldn't keep all the tissues, but I kept the last one that had a little bit on it, you know? I had to keep that as a reminder because sometimes we forget where God has pulled us from. And I needed to keep that as a reminder. But I'm very thankful for our sister, Annette, that she's being led by God. And everything that she does and she leads us, connect to it. Because God has something for you. But it doesn't stop there in the women's ministry. I used to come here and I wanted to actually get on my knees. And I couldn't get on my knees. Because my knees were so filled with liquid that as soon as I would get on my knees,
they felt that they were going to bust. I couldn't even handle a few seconds being on my knees. But one day, our pastor, Pastor George, God led him to come out here and say, God is telling me right now that God is going to move in healing. And anybody that wants healing, come up front, because God is going to heal you. And I heard our pastor's voice, that God was leading him. And when I came up, I decided to get on my knees, knowing that it was going to hurt. But I said, I have to act in faith. I got on my knees. And when I got up, I was completely healed. That's thanks to God and thanks to our leadership for hearing God's voice. But guess what? It doesn't stop there. I had a big burden when I came, one of many. And it was that I have two children. But my son, who both were raised in church, my son had gone with different friends and were in bad, real bad shape. And he did not want to come to any church, and he did not want to have anything to do with church anymore, really with God. One day, God put in my heart, after a year coming here, to invite him and his wife to go out to eat after church. You know, it's always in the food, you know? So I brought them with that bribery that I would take them anywhere they wanted to go after church. They came. But you know what? I haven't had to bribe them anymore. Because they not only connected to this church, but I am so thankful to God for our pastor, for Pastor George, because he has been more than a pastor to my son. He is like a father, a spiritual father to my son. And now my son not only comes to church, and let me tell you something that I didn't say earlier service, Pastor. You don't know what God has done to us. My son was so involved in the alcohol that one day he got on top of a roof because under the influence of alcohol, wanting to jump off a roof. That's how bad he was messed up. But it doesn't matter how bad we're messed up. There is power in Jesus' name. There is power in Jesus' name. And now my son is right there serving the Lord in the sound system. So God can make miracles. And I am very thankful for our pastors, because it's through our pastors that this ministry has brought freedom to my life and to my children. Thank you, pastors. Thank you. I love you.
I'm working on, I was telling Pops the other day that I'm working on not telling any jokes and when I talk. I want to be more theological like Dr. Westlake. So anyway, first off, I just, I want to say thank you, and that I'm grateful to be able to get up here and share my heart. And and I want you to know that not a day goes by where I don't ask God what it is that I did to deserve you guys in my life. You guys together, you showed me what real love is. You showed me what biblical love is. And the same love that you guys have between each other is the love that I strive for with Deonza. And the love that you guys have for my little brother, my brothers, Gio and Austin, and the love that you have for my little sister, Lexi, is the same fatherly love that I want to have for my kids. And, you know, I thank God that, you know, he gave me another set of parents, but I also thank him that he gave me a couple of little brothers and a little sister to protect. So just giving you a heads up. But anyway, you see, if it weren't for the faith that you guys had, I wouldn't be here today. And I want you guys to know that every youth that God has allowed me to reach while out in New York is just a testimony to what you guys have done in my life. And one of the greatest days in my life is the day that I came down to this altar and I gave my life to God. And I understand that, you know, that it's God who pulled me out of the darkness. But he used you guys to flick on that light switch. He used you guys to shine that light on my life. And I truly believe that I wouldn't be alive today, let alone standing on this stage, if it weren't for the faith that you guys put in me. You see, there was a point in my life where I jumped into a puddle, but I landed in an ocean, and life was dangerous, and I literally was wondering if my next step was gonna be death. And then death came and it missed me, but you guys showed me that death didn't miss me, but God covered me. God protected me through all of that. You know, as a church, as an individual, you guys taught us that a whole nation walked on dry land because a few people were willing to get their feet wet. And 10 years ago, you guys got your feet wet. And somewhere in between, in one of the toughest years of your guys' life, in 2009 and 2010, it was a hard time for you guys. In the midst of your own drownings, you guys took a step so that I could walk on dry land. And you guys went through one of the worst times of your life so that I could have the best time of my life. And no one knew it, including me, because of the simple fact that the faith that you guys showed on the outside, it aligned and it matched with the faith that you guys had on the inside. It wasn't just a show. And through that, you guys showed me that when you listen to God, you know, times might get tough and you might go through some struggles, but when you answer his call, man, he'll direct your path and he'll give you the desires of your heart. You guys taught us that. You taught us how good God is and how faithful God is and how understanding God is and the passion that you guys have for the lost and the broken, the passion that you guys have for this city, the passion that you guys have for my city is the same compassion that Christ shown when he walked this earth. You see, you guys showed me how to lead a youth group with God being the center of it. The way that you guys lead this church and who you are up here on stage is the same person throughout the week off of the stage. You taught me to never trade the altar for the stage. That it's never about me, but it's about God. And you know, I give credit to my mama for making me into the man that I am today. But I'm telling you that you guys turned me into the pastor that I am today. you stuck with me through this journey, all the way from telling the people, the teachers and the deans of CBC to show me some grace, all the way to giving up your Hummer just so that I could get to school. All the way to sharing our testimony with Dr. Wood and Evangel University president and all the other people in the Assemblies of God. All the way to coming out to New York to performing my wedding. You truly shown me what compassion is. And you know, I tell you this before, but I could speak a million words to tell you how thankful I am. But that will never be enough to tell you how grateful and you'll never be able to truly understand how grateful I am to you. Man, Pops, I just want to say thank you, man, because you truly saved my life, Pops.
Many years ago that Gene and I had a little boy, wanted to be a drummer all his life. He moved to Kansas City with us when he was 11 years old, 43 years ago. Now you can figure it out. Just wanted to be a drummer. He played for our choir, our youth choir. And when he graduated from high school, traveled with a gospel group all over the country playing the drums. But God said, one day it's more than that, get to Bible college. He was our youth pastor straight out of Bible college for a short time. He went to a large church in suburban Chicago, a large church with almost no young people. After he'd been there a short time, they had to have three youth pastors to handle the group. And then he moved to Fort Myers, Florida. And there they were. He was pastor to young families. And then from there, he went to Stevens Point, Wisconsin, as senior pastor. So he went in the middle of the winter from Fort Myers, Florida, to Wisconsin. Can you imagine? I remember him telling me when I hit that north, I thought I must be out of my mind. But every time he'd come home and preach, the board members would talk to me after and say, "Pastor, when's he coming back here where he belongs? Because when you step back, he's supposed to be our pastor." But we never told him. Never told him. And one day he finally called and said, "I'm supposed to be back at Sheffield." I said, "It is about time." Now, I kind of tease him. When I was voted in as pastor, we had less than 200 people. And I had to have 70% to be voted in as pastor, and I only got 73%. But when he was voted in, we had over 2,000 votes, and he got 94%. So you like him better than you like me. There are a lot of things you don't know about him. An author I read years ago said, "Men make leaders of men, but God makes leaders of servants." And Pastor and Annette are two of the greatest servants of God I've ever met in my life. And I'm not saying that there because my son. In addition to being our pastor, our senior pastor, he is assistant superintendent of the Southern Missouri District of the Assemblies of God. Now that means there's about 370 churches. When they have problems, he's the one that usually has to go and solve it. He's also a general presbyter of our general council. And because he is so highly respected there, he recently had our church debt, the interest rate, put way low, saving us a lot of money. It's going to be poured off a lot faster because of the high esteem he has among the general council. He is also on the board of Evangel University, so he is very busy. But it's amazing what God has done. When he first came here, he said, "Everywhere I go, people said, oh yeah, you're George Westlake's boy." Well, everywhere I go in the country except here, they say, "You're George Westlake's dad." He had a live television. I had a TV program for young people out of Chicago for many years. It was broadcast all over the country. We used to watch it here. So he's well known all over the country. But God brought him back here, and God has been doing such a tremendous thing the last 10 years. I'm reminded that on the Sunday when I handed it over to him, I reminded him that David was needed for a short time, but Solomon took the kingdom further than David had ever taken it. And so that's what he does. You know, being a senior pastor is a big load, and I am free. I never realized the difference because I was a senior pastor since I was 23 years old, and I turned to him when I was 75. I'm 85 now, and I always had this battle, this war. Now, I still have battle because, you know, I go all over the world teaching pastors. I go to China, go to Malaysia, go to Indonesia, go to Singapore, go to Burma, go to all these places. I still have battles, but never like when I was senior pastor of a church. You have the responsibility for the whole church. You are the overseer. That's the word translated bishop in your Bible. You are the shepherd, the pastor of the congregation, and you are the elder of the church. It's the same person, all three offices in the New Testament. So it's a tremendous responsibility. But I'm just delighted that you have that load now instead of me. Praise the Lord. And until you've been there, you can't comprehend the difference. I didn't know the difference till I wasn't senior pastor anymore. And I thought, God, I'm still having a warfare, but wow, it's easier now. But we prayed about the day he was born, about who he would marry. And we prayed and prayed and prayed. And we were so grateful that God brought Annette into his life. I know if my wife was here today, she'd say exactly the same thing. Annette, you are a beautiful Christian lady in every way. And she is an example of what a godly mother and a godly woman and a godly wife ought to be. And a great first lady for Sheffield Family Life Center. I'm going to ask them to come up here. We're going to pray for them first. George and Annette to come. Right in the center. Okay, face the congregation. Okay. Praise God. Let's pray. Father, we are so thankful today for George and Annette. Thankful for the anointing of the power of God on their lives. Thankful for the vision that you've given for this church. And we know that vision will come to pass. We know that any time you take a step for God, there's opposition. But we know that greater is he that's in us than he that's in the world. I pray you'll enlarge the vision, that you'll continue to protect them, give them health, keep them with that fresh anointing of the power of the Holy Spirit that rests upon them, and keep them as real as they always have been. Bless them abundantly, we pray, in Jesus' mighty name. And everyone said, amen. Now, those of you that have cards or gifts, you can come up. You can come up, and I'm going to ask them to stay down here. Those of you that have cards, the baskets are up here. If you want to stand with me, it'd be a lot better, but you don't have to stand the whole time. Just as you feel free to come. I know a lot of you have gifts and cards for them for their 10th anniversary. have a short video, just a couple minutes. And then I have a plaque I would like to read. It says to Reverend George W. Westlake III, October 22nd, 2006, Sheffield Family Life Center, Kansas City, Missouri. As your father, I charge you to preach the word of God without fear or favor. Live your life as an example before these people as a true shepherd of the flock of God. May your heart always be filled with a passion for God and for his people and for the lost. May you lead this church to be a lighthouse to those in darkness, a place of refreshing for the saints, a haven of the distressed and discouraged, a place of deliverance for those that are bound, and most of all, a place where the word of God is faithfully taught so that all may grow in the grace and the knowledge of the Lord. My son, I give you this staff so it will always serve as a reminder to you that you are a shepherd. A true shepherd will give his life for his sheep and will lead his sheep into green pastures and places that restore the soul. Walk each day in close relationship with the chief shepherd, Jesus Christ, so that those around you will see Jesus in your life. I'm also tempted above what I'm able to bear. I have one more presentation to make to Pastor George. You know, it's amazing what God can do. Years ago when we did the live call and question and answer television program, I was actually sitting there and a guy said he was channel surfing and he saw me sitting there and he noticed I had red socks on. And he said, I decided a preacher that will wear red socks can't be all bad. So he came to the church next Sunday and got saved. So if God can use a donkey, he can use a pair of red socks. Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane. He's prayed great drops of blood, sweat. Matter of fact, Dr. Luke calls them blood clots. Judas came with a band of soldiers to arrest him. They said, who are you seeking? Jesus of Nazareth. He said, simply, I am. Now, I know our English Bible says, I am he, but Jesus only said, I am. And they went backward and fell to the ground. What did that mean? Why did they go backward and fall to the ground? If you go back to the burning bush 1,400 years earlier, when God called Moses out of the burning bush and said, I'm sending you to deliver my people Israel. And Moses said, what am I going to tell them? What's your name? And God said, I am that I am. I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And tell them, I am has sent me unto you. And that is my name for all generations. I am. Jesus never said, I am he. He always said, I am. In John chapter 4, we know that Messiah is coming. He said, I am. In John 6, he said, I am the bread of life. The one who keeps munching on me will live forever. In John 8:58, he said, before Abraham was, I am. When they were going through the storm in the middle of the night and they saw this apparition walking on the water, he said, stop being afraid. I am. Are you aware when you're going through a storm, the things that would overwhelm you were under his feet, and he is still the great I am today. John 9:5 says, I am the light of the world. John 10:7, I am the door. John 10:36, I am the Son of God. He says in John 13:13, I am your Lord and Master. John 10, I am the Good Shepherd. John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. John 15:1, I am the genuine vine. Chapter 11:25, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever lives and believes in me will never die. How many believe that today? Say amen. In the book of Revelation, he says, I am the Alpha and the Omega. Now, that's Greek. In the English, I am the A and I am the Z. I am the beginning and I am the end. I am the first and the last. Colossians puts it this way. He is the firstborn of every created thing, for by him were thee all things created, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones, dominions, principalities, or powers. The all things were created by him and for him. He is the head of the body, the church, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence, for it pleased the Father that in him should all the fullness dwell. Jesus is the beginning. He created everything that's been created. Now, he that said, I am, I am, I am, said, I will. Not just I am, I will. And they're standing at the coast of Caesarea Philippi, and Jesus said, I will build my church. How many believe he can build his church today? I remind you just quickly, he preserved Noah in the ark. He gave Abraham and Sarah a baby when they were 90 and 100. He took Joseph from a slave to a throne. He took Moses, who thought, I can't do anything, and anointed him with his power. The leader had been educated at government expense. He delivered them out of the bondage of Egypt. He led them through the Red Sea. He gave them manna to eat every day and gave them water from the rock to drink. He kept their shoes from wearing out 40 years in the desert. Mine don't last anywhere near 40 years. I don't know about yours. The shoes of their feet didn't wear out. He took his people to the promised land through the River Jordan. He caused the sun to stand still. He knocked down the walls of Jericho. He took the stone from David's head. Goliath's head. He fireproofed Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He closed the lion's mouths for Daniel. He fed 5,000 men beside women and children. He made eyes for the man born blind. He turned water into wine. You know, a lot of people say, Pastor Westlake, you don't drink wine. Jesus turned water into wine. I said, give me the same brand and I'll drink it. Okay, he cast out the legion of demons. He calmed the storm. He raised Lazarus from the dead. Lazarus, hear out. And Lazarus came out of the grave. Can he build his church? When Jesus said, I will build my church, he saw the apostles denying him and running from the garden. He knew about the opposition of the Roman Empire, how the church would be persecuted for the next 300 years. He knew about the darkness of the Middle Ages, but he said, I will build my church. He knew about the rise of Islam, the rise of communism. He knew about the teaching of evolution, which caused one Nobel Prize winner in Norway. He received the Nobel for prize. He said that evolution is the biggest hoax ever perpetrated on the human race. Honey, you can believe you evolved from a monkey if you want, but I'm here because God created man out of the dust of the earth and breathed into man's nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. He knew about the World Council of Churches that no longer believes the Bible, but he said, I will build my church. He knew about the liberal media in America that's anti-Christian, but he said, I will build my church. He knew all about the liberal Supreme Court, but he said, I will build my church. He knew about the Anti-Christian Liars Union, the ACLU, that believes in freedom of speech for everybody but children of God. Thank God we serve one that said, I will build my church. And he said, the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Now, the gates of a city were where the elders meant to plan their military strategy. How to defeat the enemy. And the enemy has always had a plan since he was thrown out of heaven to try to defeat the plan of God. I know 10 years ago when I shared with Pastor George the story of Joshua, where God said, Moses, my servant, is dead. Therefore, you take the children of Israel into the land that I promised. And I will be with you. As I was with Moses, I was with you. And I told them, God will be with you. And I'm glad his Moses hasn't died yet, all right? But the things I didn't remind him of, that once you get into Jordan, there's a Jericho ahead. Once you get in there, there's the Hivites and the Perizzites and the Girgashites and the Philistines that will stand. Once you get in there, there's going to be a 9.5-foot tall man named Goliath. Once you are in there, is going to come the king of Assyria with his mighty army and make mockery of the king, because he said, no one can stand before my enemies, but no one can stand before my master, the king. But that night, God killed 180,000 Assyrians, and they went back to their own country in defeat. Yes, and I remind him today, and I remind you, as you're doing something for God, there will be Jerichos, there will be Goliaths, there will be the Hittites, but the walls of Jericho will fall, the Goliaths will be defeated, the Hittites will be driven out by the power of the resurrected Son of God. The gates of hell will not prevail. Jesus said, upon this rock I will build my church. And what is the rock? It's Peter's statement. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. You see, the church is his. Now, I've been pastoring since I was 23 years old. And we pastored at a place up in Michigan in the tip of the thumb called Bad Axe, A-X-E, all right? That's where Pastor George was born. And it was a little town of 3,000 people. And I pastor an Assembly of God church. Y'all know me and all Pastor Joe. We won't compromise on what the Bible teaches. We live in an age when people are more concerned. You got to be politically correct. You can't tell things like they are. Honey, we need to be biblically correct, not politically correct. But we had a man in that church. He was the church treasurer. He was the biggest giver in the church. Okay, he was a Sunday school superintendent. Of course, he was on the church board. And he didn't believe in speaking in tongues in an Assembly of God church. Well, I will not compromise the gospel because prayer and the Spirit is one of the greatest gifts God has ever given his people. And I will not compromise the gospel. And I didn't know what to do. I was a young pastor. And my mother had a friend. Her best friend was named Hattie Hammond. Hattie Hammond was an old-fashioned camp meeting preacher. She had just spoken at the World Pentecostal Conference in Stockholm to 5,000 people. And she called my mother and said, I'm supposed to preach at George's church. Well, do you think he'll have me? So my mother called me and said, would you consider having Hattie Hammond? I said, you're kidding. How soon? I want her to come as soon as she can, one of the greatest preachers I've ever heard. The very first service after the church, we went back to the house we were living in, and she'd been an opera singer when she was younger. She said, George, who is that pompous peacock sitting in the front of that church defying the Spirit of the living God? And I told her, she said, God's going to move him out of your church. Well, in that little church, in 1 week with 54 people, 39 of them got baptized in the Holy Spirit. Tremendous move of God. And word got around, Brother Weidman is leaving. So I went over to the church, and I thought I better give God some advice. I had a Baptist pastor friend, didn't believe speaking in tongues was a day, and he went home one night and started praising the Lord in the bathtub, and God baptized him in the Holy Spirit, started speaking a language you never knew. So I had it all figured out how God should do it. You got to put Brother Wyman in the bathtub, you got to baptize. I've given God advice for 60 years, and he's never listened once, fortunately. How many of you like to do that? Yeah, how many of you like to pray, give me this day my yearly bread? But it just doesn't work that way. Well, word got around that Brother Weidman was leaving, but so I went on about three hours. I said, God, we're already living on starvation wages. His older sister Linda was just a baby. I said, we got a new baby. What are we going to do if he leaves? I will not compromise the gospel. He's the biggest giver in the church. What are we going to do? And when I finally got quiet and shut my mouth about 3 hours later, God says, whose church is this, yours or mine? And he gave me that scripture, upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. I said, God, it's your church. He said, I'll take care of it. We lost that family, one other family. The next 3 months, we quadrupled in income and tripled in attendance. The church is his, and he will take care of it. He is a miracle-working God. Now, Pastor George told you last week about some of the difficulties a few years ago where people were saying we're going to have to sell the church and we're going bankrupt and all those kind of things because it is harder in the inner city, but it's easier to run out to the suburbs. But I want to remind you of the thing. When I came here 43 years ago, well, my pastor friend said, you got to get the church out of the city. They said, number one, you can't finance a church in the city anymore. It won't work. But secondly, they said suburban people won't drive in. I told them I didn't know only suburban people were important to God, and we were going to stay in the city till Jesus comes instead of running out to the suburbs. Now, my very first service as pastor in the little building on the corner across the street, one of the deacons got up and said, we have an insurance bill. Who's going to give 100? Who's going to give 50? Who's going to give 20? And after that meeting, I told the board members, as long as I'm pastor, we are never, 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 never going to do that again. We're going to teach people the blessing of giving God the tithe, the blessing of giving God the offering, and God will take care of it. And I said, I don't care if we operate in the red 5 years. We operate in the red 10 years, okay? Every week it was, who do we pay? But Jesus said, upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Well, we ran out of room. There was a Vickers gas station sitting over here where the gymnasium sits. We tried to buy it. They said it's not for sale. Started getting robbed every week, and we didn't do it. And eventually they called and said, we'll have to have what we have in it. We found out they had $250,000 in it. We prayed. They called back the next week, said, how does $25,000 sound? So we got the Vickers gas station over there. Then no bank in town would loan us $1 million to build the building. So I called our general counsel, and they loaned us $1 million. And the gymnasium was built in 1985. But my pastor friend said, it can't be done. My God can build a church anywhere. He wants to build his church. And then we ran out of room about the end of the 1990s. And where this building sits was our parking lot at the time. Right next door was a 13-acre sanitary landfill. I called and said, how much is it? $550,000. I sent them a letter and offered them $25,000. I never got an answer to my letter. But to make a long story short, about a month after that, we got this 13 acres for $5,000. That God will build his church. But then no one would loan us the money to build. Matter of fact, they sell bonds to build churches, and the bonding company said, we're not going to do that for an inner city church. Your people can't buy the bonds, and nobody outside the city is going to buy them. So we said, God, you gave us this property. You want the church building. What are we going to do? When we got out of the way, the vice president of the Bank of America called me. He said, we like what you're doing in the city. If you need to build, we'll loan you money way below prime. If your general counsel will take the note when you're finished. And I called the general counsel, and our superintendent said, go ahead. We built this building, the whole complex on both sides of the street, with no money. Why? He said he will build his church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Now, I don't know what kind of enemies we're going to have in the future, but I know the God that's performed miracles in the past will not stop doing what he's already done. And the greater days are in the future for this church. Praise God! Now, the enemy always has sneaky ways of doing things. Right after we built the gymnasium, some of our biggest givers were coming to us and saying, we're leaving the church. Why? Well, we heard the money's not being handled properly. We lost 500 people in about a year. And we couldn't find out what was going on. We're rumor after rumor after rumor after rumor that wasn't true. And then we found out it was one of our staff members who was trying to get people to leave here and go to one of his relatives' church that we had helped start. And finally, I found out one of our Sunday school teachers came and said, why are you going to fire me? I said, why should I fire you? He said, well, so-and-so says that you're going to fire me, so I need to go to the other church. And we finally found out who was doing it. So I just told him, why don't you go and work at the other church? You'd be a lot better off if you go work at the other church. You know what he told people for years? Sheffield mistreated him and told him to leave. But you see, I never criticized the man. You don't know who he is. I never criticized him. I always made him feel welcome when I saw him, because God hasn't called us to hurt people. He's called us to help people. That's the message of the gospel. But it was really a struggle financially. It's always been a struggle here. We're not like the suburban churches where someone drops $500,000 in the offering. We have no huge givers in this church, but this church depends on each one being faithful. And I want you to know, as long as the people that make this church their church home do what God said to do, the ministry will increase and continue to grow when we're faithful to God. Because he said, I will build my church. And so God took care of it. And by the way, after this person left, we had the biggest growth in the history of the church the next couple of years. So he is the builder of his church. He knows exactly what he's doing. A lot of people came to me and said, Pastor, As a matter of fact, my daughters did. They said, Dad, you're wanted other churches. You don't have to put up with all this. And I said, I'm not going to run out when we're having a difficult time. And he heard about the difficult time around about the year 2010 since George had been in charge, and he didn't run off. He stayed here to get the job done for the kingdom of God. The hireling flees. The shepherd stays and fights the shepherd. Though the gates of hell will not prevail, because Jesus is the rock of the church. The rock of the church is Peter's statement, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Upon this rock I'll build my church. We're not built on religion. We're not built on the assemblies of God. We're not built on any particular person. We are built and anchored in the Lord Jesus Christ himself. In the rock of God is whom I trust. Psalmist said, when my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that's higher than I. Now, how does he build his church? Remember the day he went back to Nazareth? And what'd they say? The carpenter's here. Why, we probably got chairs and tables that were made by him in his carpenter shop. He is a carpenter. That's right, Jesus Christ is a carpenter. You come into this church, and I think it turned out to be a nice building. The carpet's nice. You see the carpet, you see the pews, you see all this fancy stuff they had for the concert the other night. And you see all the things that are here, and you see the people, and you think, wow, this is a good, nice church to come to. It's a good place to bring our family. But that's not the main reason the devil can't destroy the church. That's not the reason the bands of sin are broken. That's not the reason people are healed. That's not the reason people get comfort. That's not the reason people leave filled with peace. The reason is that he that is the I Am is moving up and down the aisles of this church by the power of his Holy Spirit. And he's here to heal. He's here to deliver. He's here to set free. He's here to give you what you need. He is the center of what's going on here. It's to his praise, his glory, his is the kingdom, his is the power, and he will not fail to build his church. Praise God. Come unto me, ye that labor under heavy laden, he said. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light, and you'll find rest for your souls. So he desires to build his church. Jesus told the parable. A man was walking through a field, and he saw a buried treasure. He went and sold everything he had and bought the field that he might mine out the treasure. That's not a parable of us. That's a parable of Jesus. He's the one that sold everything he had to buy the field. In the parables of Jesus, the field is the world, and the treasures are those that are willing to believe in him and become his jewels according to the word of God. Jesus came and bought this whole world. The Bible says, oh, he was rich, yet for our sakes he became poor, that we through his poverty might be made rich. You know why he laid aside the form of God and became a man? You know why he was willing to go to the cross and suffer for 6 long hours on the cross of Calvary? You know how he was willing to become a baby? God the Son, who became a baby at a point in time. God has always existed as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. At a point in time, the Bible says in Isaiah said, unto us a child is born and a son is given. God the Son was given, but born as a child. Unto us a child is born, a son is given, and the government shall be on his shoulders, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there shall be no end, and he will sit upon the throne of David to establish with judgment and justice from now on even forever. He was willing to become a man. You know, the Bible says, all we like sheep have gone astray. We turned everyone to his own way. You know what that made? We said, God, just butt out. Leave me alone. I want to run my own life. Now, we didn't say it, but we lived like it. You did, and I did. And God, being holy, can't pretend I didn't do that, can't pretend you didn't do it. And so God said, I've got to punish that sin. And so God, the Son, became a baby, grew up as a man, lived for 33 and a half years without sinning. And God took all of your sin and all of my sin and put on him and punished him in our place on the cross of Calvary. And because he paid your sin bill, if you go up and see your book in heaven, it will say righteous, not guilty of ever having sinned. Your bill has been wiped out by Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Why, the Bible says, he that has the Son has life. And he that doesn't have the Son does not have life. You don't get your sin washed away by baptism. You don't get it washed away by communion. You don't get it washed away by mass. You don't get it washed away by joining a church. You get it washed away when you receive Jesus Christ and you're born again by the power of the Holy Spirit. He paid the whole bill. He bought the whole world that he might mine out the treasure. But then he says, the one that said, I will build my church, he wants you to take part in that building. You know, we have a lot of things that Jesus called the church. He called it the church, the Bible called it, church of God, church of Christ, firstborn written in heaven, the temple of the living God. The church is the pillar of ground and truth. It is called the assembly, the body of Christ, the bride of Christ, the fullness of him who fills all in all. It is a holy nation, a peculiar people, a royal priesthood, but it is also the army of God, and we're not called to hold the fort. We're called to storm the forces of hell by the mighty power of God and snatch people that are headed for hell. How many of you know someone that's not a Christian? Let me see your hand. What did you do about it this week? How many know someone's dropped out of a church? Let me see you. What did you do about it this week? Bring them to hear Pastor George next Sunday. 90% of all people that are saved because a friend invites them to church. God hasn't called us just to sit by. He wants us to go out into this community and tell people there's a God in heaven. The great I Am is alive, and he can minister to your need today by his power when you come and hear what he has to say. The gates of hell will not prevail against the church. Now, the gates of hell, when Peter said, you're the Christ, the Son of the living God, he was at Caesarea Philippi. And up on the hill was a big cave where the origins of the Jordan River came flowing out of. And the Greeks believed that was the entrance to the river Styx, the gateway to hell. And so Jesus said, upon this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell, Hades, will not prevail against it. Now, the word translated hell in your Bible in the Old Testament is Sheol in Hebrew, it's Hades in Greek. But Jesus explained what Hades was like. Are you aware in the Old Testament only two people went to heaven prior to Jesus coming? Everybody else died, was gathered to their fathers in the heart of the earth, every single person. Jacob said, I'm going to go to Joseph, and he thought Joseph had been eaten by a wild beast. I will go down to my son Joseph. And then Hades was divided into two parts, one where the rich man was, the other one where Lazarus was, in the story of the rich man and Lazarus. The rich man was in torment. Lazarus was a guest of honor at a feast, and that was called paradise. And there in that, let's say one day a man walked into Hades that had never been there before. And he saw Adam. He said, what are you waiting for? He said, I'm waiting for the seed of the woman who's coming to crush the head of the serpent. Why are you doing there, Abel? I'm looking for the one whose blood speaks better things than mine. What are you waiting for, Noah? I'm waiting for the one who is the true ark of safety. What are you waiting for, Abraham and Sarah? We're waiting for that descendant of ours in whom all nations of the earth are going to be blessed. What about Rahab, Ruth, and Tamar, the Moabitess, the Canaanitess, and the prostitute of Jericho? Who are you waiting for? We're waiting for the one that told us we were going to be ancestors of the coming King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Joshua, who are you waiting for? I'm waiting for the captain of the Lord host that I saw before we fought the walled city of Jericho. Jacob, who are you waiting for? I'm waiting for the one that wrestled with me that night and turned me from Jacob the supplanter into Israel the Prince of God. Isaiah, who are you waiting for? I'm waiting for the one whose name is called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. Jeremiah, who are you waiting for? I'm waiting for the Divine Potter that shaped my life. Ezekiel, what about you? I'm waiting for that one I saw sitting on the throne in the wheel in the middle of the wheel. Daniel, I'm waiting for that stone cut out without hands who's going to rule this world. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who are you looking for? The one we saw in the midst of the fiery furnace. Moses, who are you waiting for? The great prophet like me, the one that gave me the commandments. And who are you waiting for? Well, I'm the keeper of the keys, and someday somebody's going to take them away. And he said, I am! I am! I am! Praise God. He snatched the keys out of the hands. And you read in the book of Revelation, I am the living one and became dead. And I have the keys of hell and of death, Hades and of death. And what does he say? In the Old Testament, when they died, the gates of Hades closed around them. But the gates of Hades have been ripped open. And when you and I close our breath here, we'll immediately step into the presence of God to be absent from the bodies, to be present with the Lord. He is. How many believe he can build his church? Say amen. Amen. I could go on and on all day, but the devil invented clocks. He also said, I will come again. I will come again. Now we know the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. And we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. So shall we ever be with the Lord. But he is coming back for more than just the church. In Revelation 4 and 5, you have the great scene in heaven. You have the four living ones, the multitude that no man can number. And you have God sitting on the throne. And in his hand, there's a seven-seal book. Now, I remind you, a book in the Bible is a scroll written on the inside and on the backside, which would be on the outside, and sealed with seven seals. Now, every picture in the book of Revelation is explained somewhere in the Bible. And Jeremiah and the book of Leviticus explain this. If I mortgage my inheritance, I put down what I have to pay to get my house back. It would be sealed up, one name on the outside. If I couldn't pay my bill, only my nearest relative here could open this book and see how to get me my inheritance back. And when we read, I saw in the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book written within and on the backside and sealed with seven seals. And I heard a mighty angel say, no man in heaven or earth was worthy to take the book and to loose their seals thereof. And John said, I cried much because no man could look in the book. John knew what this was. He knew that in the Garden of Eden, God put everything under Adam and Eve's control. He gave them the authority of this world. He gave them dominion. But sin came and they sold out to the devil. Satan became the ruler of this age. Death and misery and pain and sorrow came into this world. And John understood, until someone can take that book and open it up and see what has to happen to give man back his inheritance, sin and crime and misery and pain are going to continue. And John says, I wept much because no man could open the book. And when the living ones says, stop your crime. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root and offspring of David, has prevailed to take the book and to loose the seals thereof. And I turned and I saw a lamb as it had been slain, having seven eyes and seven horns, which are the seven spirits of God. And he walks over and takes the book out of the Father's hand. And you hear the great praise, you've redeemed us by your blood out of every kindred, tongue, tribe, and nation, and have made us unto our God kings and priests, and we shall reign upon the earth. In chapter 6, he starts to open the book, and in chapter 10, as our nearest relative, as our kinsman redeemer, he puts one foot on the sea, one foot on the dry land, and says, I'm taking it back. No more time for sin, no more time for death, no more time for sorrow, no more time for bad. We win because Jesus wins. Praise God. Hallelujah. Things might get bad, but we win. How many have read the back of the book? Praise God. What if it was today? Do you know Jesus? I'm asking if you want to join this church. The Bible says, as many as receive him, he becomes the children of God. The Bible says, he that has the Son has life. I've already quoted that. And he that doesn't have the Son does not have life. The Bible says the Holy Spirit bears witness with our spirit that we're children of God. That means if Jesus Christ is living in your life, you know it. It's not something you hope so, think so, or suppose so. Do you know Jesus Christ today? Not that you want to join this church. We're not the way to heaven. Jesus is the only way. He said, I'm the way, I'm the truth, the life, and nobody comes to the Father but by me. But by me. Would you bow your heads with me, please? I wonder, as every head is bowed and every eye closed, do you know Jesus? Maybe you're here today and you say, Pastor, I'm not sure. I need Jesus Christ in my life. I want to know him for myself. Pray for me. Just slip your hand up and down. I want to know Jesus Christ. See a number of hands. A number of hands. I see a number of hands. Father, I pray for those that raise their hands that you continue to draw them by your Spirit. We know the very fact that they raise their hands, and others that should have, felt they should have. It's you knocking at the door of their heart. And you said, I've taken my stand at the door, and I'm knocking, and if anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I'll come in and feast with him and he with me. You want a relationship with every person here. I'm going to ask you to repeat after me, the whole congregation. God loves me as if I'm the only person he ever had to love. I am as important to God as anyone who has ever lived. And if I'd have been the only one that sinned, Jesus would have died just for me. Father, I pray now you'll do what only you can do in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Please stand with me, but please don't leave. Stand with me. Can we have our altar workers, please? Jesus said this. He said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father which is in heaven. I was in a service like this when I was 19, baptized church member, but I didn't know Jesus. That night I stepped out of my seat, a man led me in a prayer, and Jesus Christ changed my life. I'm 85 now, and it gets better every day. Changed my life radically. And he wants to change your life today. Just come and let someone pray with you, and Jesus Christ will set you free. If you're a man will pray with you. If you're a lady will pray with you. We're not going to ask you to join this church. Again, we're not the way to heaven. But if you need Jesus, I saw a lot of hands. So just step out and let someone pray for you as the praise singers lead us in praise.
Oh,
he'll change your life this morning.
Victory belongs to Jesus.
Victory he'll make you new. That's something making you come. That's the Spirit of God. I want you to do this is how I was saved. Turn to the person next to you. Say, if you want to go down and pray, I'll go with you. Go ahead. If you want to go down and pray, I'll go with you.
Victory belongs to Him.
I know the enemy will lie to you. I thought I was finished. Many of you don't know Elizabeth Davenport. I have permission to give her testimony anytime I feel impressed. Elizabeth Davenport was kidnapped as a middle school girl, taken down by the Missouri River. That's not the rapture, we're all still here. She was taken down by the Missouri River, raped over and over. The man was going to throw her in the Missouri River and kill her. She woke up in the hospital. Like unfortunately happens to so many people, she felt unclean. She thought, no one would ever want me. She was on drugs and alcohol in her early 20s. She woke up one morning at home, didn't know how she got home. A strong male voice said, I brought you home last night, go to church. She was driving around, stopped here and came into the service. She said, I was getting ready to walk out, and I just thought to myself, God couldn't care about a nasty little girl like me. And God dropped something on my heart. And I said, there's someone here saying God couldn't care about a nasty person like me. And one of our ladies walked all the way across the auditorium and said it's you, brought her down to pray with her. Today, she and her husband hold revivals in the biggest prisons in America. She is the preacher. Matter of fact, they're on a 2-month trip now to 50 different prisons, high level, death row. Listen, I don't care where you've been. The devil will say, look at you. Who do you think you are? I'll tell you who you are. You're the person God loves and wants to set you free this morning. And there's someone here that needs that. Stop letting the devil bring your past up. When you come to Jesus, you have no past. It's under the blood of Christ. He'll set you free. Come and let him set you free this morning. There's someone here God's talking to. I don't do this. There's someone here God's talking to. Stop letting the devil lie to you. Turn again. Say, if you want to go down and pray, I'll go with you. Praise God. God bless you. Praise God. Who else is God talking to? Praise God. Praise God. The devil is a liar. Well, let people out of the aisle. Well, let them out of the aisle. Come on. Let them out. Folks are coming. Folks are coming. Praise God. Praise God. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise God. Let's give the Lord a big shout of praise for victory. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, mighty God, mighty God. Bring somebody with you next Sunday. Take them out for dinner if you have to. Let God use you. God bless you. Praise God. Thank you.